This has been a Gildan Audio production. For more affordable, life-changing audio programs, visit our website at gildanmedia.com.
Gildan Media proudly presents The Values Factor, The Secret to Creating an Inspired and Fulfilling Life. Written by Dr. John DeMartini. Narrated by Erik Synnestvedt. Chapter 1. What is the Values Factor? Your beliefs become your thoughts. Your thoughts become your words. Your words become your actions. Your actions become your habits. Your habits become your values. Your values become your destiny. Mahatma Gandhi. What is the most important step you can take to achieve the inspired and fulfilling life you've dreamed of? You might think the answer was something like, start saving money, get a better job, or land that big promotion. Or maybe your response would be more like, find my life partner, have a baby, or improve my marriage. Perhaps your thoughts turn to such general answers as, go back to school, take more time to travel, or spend more time pursuing a spiritual practice. Any of those actions might help you create a more well-rounded life, perhaps even a more meaningful one. But none of them alone will be the key to fulfilling your destiny. None of them alone may even come close. Why? Because until you understand specifically what you truly value most, what truly inspires you, who you truly are, and what your true purpose is, a completely inspired, fulfilling life will elude you. You are likely to attempt to live the life that someone else wants you to live, trying to follow someone else's values or priorities, those of a parent, teacher, boss, or spouse. That is a recipe for frustration. The job that never quite satisfies you, the relationship that has somehow gone stale, and the vague sense that you're living a quiet life of desperation. What if you are living according to your own highest values, but you are not completely aware of those values, nor appreciating what they actually are? If so, you are not able to experience the full rewards of your daily efforts. Our highest values are the key to helping us define and meet our goals. They alert us to opportunities we might otherwise have missed, and they allow us to tap into our own physical, mental, and spiritual powers. Being only partly aware of your highest values can cause you to overlook many of life's opportunities, while blocking you from full access to your own abilities. That is why I say that determining your highest values is one of the most important actions you could ever take. Determining your highest values is the key to living your inspired destiny. You'll be able to build a career where every day can feel like a vacation because you love the work you do. You'll be able to find the life partner that you seek, or transform your current relationship into the intimate, nourishing partnership that you would love. You'll be able to activate your own unique genius, grow your financial freedom, expand your influence, and unleash your vitality. Ultimately, you will be able to achieve your immortal vision, fulfilling your purpose for being here on Earth. Understanding your highest values, and then using those values to achieve your most meaningful goals, is the key to transforming a quiet life of desperation into an amazing life of inspiration. And what is the secret to understanding your highest values? That's where the values factor comes in. Living by your values. I'm going to make a confession. Although I'd like to think of myself as a hard-working, dedicated person, and although my family and colleagues would probably describe me as such, I seldom feel as though I'm working hard. Those 18-hour days and that intense travel schedule to fulfill my international speaking engagements do not seem like hard work. Quite the contrary, they seem like the best vacation in the world. Exactly what I'd love to be doing, even though I'm at a point in life where I don't have to work. Likewise, if you saw my dozen or so international best-selling books, or if you looked at the research I do to keep my work fresh and up to date, you might think that I'm a disciplined person. I'm not so sure that I am. But it doesn't matter, because when you're doing something you love, you don't think of it in terms of discipline. Fulfilling your purpose is so rewarding, you just can't wait to get out there and do it. That's how I feel about my life. I can't wait to get up each day to research, write, travel, and teach. The teaching I do, the books I write, the research I conduct, and the travel I undertake are the most inspiring and satisfying activities I can envision. I can't wait to begin my next seminar. I look forward to meeting my next client. I'm enthused about sitting down with new material to prepare my next book. And my intense travel schedule, which often has me visiting numerous cities and countries in a matter of days, is the icing on the cake. Why has my life worked out to be so inspiring to me? Not because I'm unusually lucky, or ambitious, or effective at making money. My life has blossomed because I live according to my highest values, researching, writing, traveling, and teaching, and I set my goals and intentions accordingly. I've reaped enormous rewards from understanding my highest values and using them to set my goals. Knowing that my highest values are researching, writing, traveling, and teaching has enabled me to choose a career and build a business based on realizing these values at their highest level. Because I'm pursuing and living according to my highest values wholeheartedly, I have complete access to my physical, mental, and spiritual resources, my leadership, my creativity, and my energy. Because everything in my life is aligned toward meeting my values, my whole life feels meaningful and rich. Work is meaningful and fulfilling when it's something that you truly love to do. Life is intensely satisfying when it's full of people and activities that align with your highest values. And relationships based on mutual appreciation of both people's highest values are fulfilling at a level that is hard to imagine until you've experienced it for yourself. Understanding the values factor has enabled me to live an extraordinary life. As soon as you understand the values factor, you can live a life that is equally extraordinary. You already have within you everything you need to create such a life. The key is knowing and understanding your highest values, and then using them to determine your goals. In this book, I'll show you exactly how to do that. How I discovered the values factor. The first time I became aware of the power of the values factor, I was only 17 years old. I was born with my hand and foot turned inward, so I had to wear hand and leg braces in early childhood. And I was also born left-handed, which in those days was considered sinister. The efforts of my parents, teachers, and doctors to correct my problems created a number of additional learning challenges, besides contributing to my sense that something was not exactly normal with me. Accordingly, I was diagnosed with dyslexia and a speech impediment, conditions that made it difficult for me to read, write, and speak. In first grade, my teacher told my parents that I would never amount to much, and I had a challenging time in elementary school from then on. Finally, at age 14, I dropped out of school and left home. I headed first for the Texas beaches, then for California, and finally on to Hawaii, where I became a full-time surfer, living hand-to-mouth. My plan was to learn to make surfboards, and occasionally work other odd jobs to sustain my free-spirited surfing lifestyle, which I assumed would go on indefinitely. A few years later, though, I almost died of strychnine and cyanide poisoning as a result of inadequate nutrition, in combination with the consumption of excessive numbers of Hawaiian baby woodrose seeds, psilocybin mushrooms, and other toxic psychedelic hallucinogens. My life was headed downward fast. But the downward spiral was interrupted at age 17, when a local woman just happened to find me deathly sick, partly unconscious and dehydrated, in my tent in the Haleiwa Point jungle. This kind woman ran immediately to get me fresh fruit juices to rehydrate me. She helped me recover, cleaned up my tent, and then took me to a nearby health food store in Haleiwa called Vim and Vigor, where she helped replenish my body with quality, nutritious food. I became a regular customer at Vim & Vigor, and a few days later, I noticed a flyer in its door inviting people to a special guest lecture at the Sunset Recreation Hall on the North Shore of Oahu, to be presented by famous naturopath and longevity specialist Paul C. Bragg. I had never before been to a lecture of this type, and I had never heard of Paul Bragg, but my intuition told me to attend. I later found out that millions of people around the United States knew Paul Bragg for his teachings on how to enhance vitality and well-being, and possibly also to extend lives. That evening changed my life. I sat with a few dozen other teenagers, listening to this inspired, wise, elderly gentleman, the remarkable, legendary figure who had once inspired health and fitness pioneer Jack LaLanne. Paul inspired me, too. When I heard him explain how to use universal or natural laws, along with our inner powers, to become ageless and vital, and to fulfill our unique, amazing purpose, it awakened something dormant deep within me. I realized that I had the power to mold my own life into any shape I chose. This sense of empowerment was a revelation to me. As a high school dropout who had been told in first grade that I would probably never be able to read, write, communicate, or amount to anything, I had a secret, suppressed desire to be intelligent and well-read, like my older sister Lynn. I wanted to learn more about the world and to become important enough to make a difference in it. But I had accepted everything I had been told about my so-called limitations, and so I had held myself back. Upon hearing Paul Bragg share his wisdom and inspiration that night, I felt for the first time in my life that just maybe I could break through my learning limitations and actually read and become intelligent. At that age, I understood that goal to mean becoming a teacher, someone who could understand and teach these natural laws. My love for traveling also inspired a vision that night of traveling to every country on the face of the earth and sharing what I learned with millions of people. Paul Bragg's inspiring words helped me to understand my previously hidden highest values, researching and studying, so that I could understand the universal laws of which he spoke, and then writing, traveling, and teaching, so that I could share them with my fellow humans all over the globe. These are the highest values that were awakened in me that night, and that have guided my life for more than 40 years. Understanding my highest values and purpose has enabled me to achieve remarkable things. First, I was able to overcome obstacles that had previously defeated me. When you actually begin to take the high-priority actions that are truly most meaningful to you, your self-worth and self-confidence increase, making you feel as though you can overcome any impediment that seems to block your chosen path. And that is what happened to me. Bringing my life into congruence with my true purpose inspired me to keep practicing my reading. I also drew strength from the affirmation that Paul Bragg encouraged me to say to myself each day, I am a genius, and I apply my wisdom. And so I gradually broke through my dyslexic learning limitations. With steadfast dedication, I gradually mastered reading and writing. I went on to get a BS from the University of Houston, and then to get special honors from Texas Chiropractic College when I got my doctorate there. But I didn't wait to finish school to start teaching. As early as age 18, I began working with students who just seemed to be spontaneously attracted to whatever I was learning and inspired by. My first pupil was a large African-American woman who came to me to learn more about health. Then an Iranian man came to me, also seeking a healthier way of life, followed by a German man. Soon I was meeting with 16 students every day in the college library. Then I was leading an open-air class of more than 100 students in the Central Park at the University of Houston. By the time I was 23, I was teaching students nearly every night in a wide variety of venues, in my apartment, in nearby health food stores, at local colleges, and at my professional school. I continued teaching for several years, until I had finally graduated from Texas Chiropractic College and opened my practice. At that point, I began offering regular evening events for the public. Then I appeared on local radio and television shows. Eventually, I began speaking to even larger live audiences, first at state conventions, then at national meetings, and finally to huge global audiences from all walks of life. Ultimately, then, I was able to fulfill my mission by serving millions of people all around the world, while creating for myself a life that is so fulfilling, it feels almost like a vacation, even when I'm working 18 hours a day, 7 days a week. Being true to myself and to my highest values enabled me to access my deepest reserves of power, inspiration, genius, and creativity, as I will explain further in the chapters that lie ahead. To see the power of knowing your own highest values, however, you have only to compare the homeless 17-year-old working odd jobs and risking his health with a vital, creative educator delving deep into his research and sharing his knowledge with the millions of people around the globe. I experienced the benefits of the values factor firsthand, which is why I believe in its extraordinary power. These benefits are not available only to me. They are the rewards that await all people who are true to themselves and their highest values. They are based on a profound truth that I have been exploring ever since that fateful day more than 40 years ago. Everybody has a hierarchy of values. And when you live according to your highest values, that's when you liberate the most authentic you, the most empowered you, the most inspired you, and the most creative you. Living according to your highest values is the secret to living an inspired and fulfilling life. Using the values factor. Although Paul Bragg helped me unlock the secret of the values factor for myself, I did not immediately understand how to communicate the secret to others so that I could help them create their own extraordinary lives. This understanding emerged from years of teaching my signature seminar program, The Breakthrough Experience, where I have helped tens of thousands of people set goals and break through their limitations. Some of my insights into the importance of the values factor came from my observations as I worked with thousands of students over several decades. As I helped people achieve their breakthroughs, I began to notice the underlying structure that enabled people to move forward more quickly with their lives and that empowered them as they made ongoing changes. This underlying structure, I came to realize, was twofold. The values that each person held, as well as the voids, apparent lacks, or challenges that he or she had experienced. I'll explain this notion of values and voids more extensively later in this chapter, and also in Chapter 3. My observations were supported by my ongoing research into the structure and function of the brain, as well as into psychology, philosophy, and physics. I also studied the lives of high achievers and leaders, seeking to understand what had driven them to their exemplary achievements while enabling their striking accomplishments. As we shall see throughout this book, people who live extraordinary lives of inspiration and fulfillment have aligned their goals with their highest values. That is, they have chosen goals that are congruent with their highest values, rather than seeking to live out the values of others. Or in some cases, they have found ways to align their values in service of their chosen goals. I will explain how you can identify your own deepest values in Chapter 3, and I will show you how to align your goals and your highest values in many chapters throughout this book. All of these insights into the values factor flowed naturally from the Breakthrough Experience seminar, where I helped people realize that they hold within themselves, at every moment, everything they need, want, or admire in others. This realization held undeniable power, and it led my students to achieve greater fulfillment in numerous areas of their lives, including business, love, finance, education, and relationships of all kinds. But I also saw that many people could attain even greater personal and professional power if they only became aware of their own highest values. By definition, these people were in fact living out their own highest values, focusing on what was really most important to them, because that is what all humans do. However, they were not necessarily aware of these true highest values, or in some cases were uncomfortable about acknowledging them. As a result, they were at odds with themselves, unable to be fully honest or aware about who they really were and what they really wanted. Consequently, they were not fully able to mobilize all of their physical, mental, and spiritual resources to make their goals come true. Becoming aware of their highest values would enable that kind of mobilization, potentially bringing them greater fulfillment in all areas. Also, I found that students who were aware of their highest values had a clear advantage, because their self-awareness enabled them to more easily and quickly make the decisions that would most fulfill their purpose in life, while inspiring them with the energy and stamina to work tirelessly toward that purpose. Over my decades as a human behavior specialist, I honed these concepts as I worked with educators, schools, and some of the world's largest corporations and organizations, as well as with tens of thousands of students in my seminars. Based on my work in education, business, and human development, I was able to create a set of exercises to help my students realize their highest values and set their goals accordingly. I share those exercises with you in this book. The power of the values factor is extraordinary. The people I've worked with have used this approach to build businesses, find their life partners, recover from chronic pain and illness, repair relationships with spouses, parents, and children, and reconnect to their deepest spiritual callings. These exercises embody the methods I've used to create and sustain my own extraordinary life. Both my own achievements and those of my students remind me every day of the immense power in realizing your highest values and setting your goals accordingly. If there is one thing my time on Earth has taught me, it is the remarkable ability of human beings to overcome obstacles, transform their most challenging situations, and find profound meaning in their lives. But the key to this transformation, each and every time, is the values factor. Knowing your highest values enables you to align your life's actions with the things that mean the most to you. Not being aware of those highest values makes it exponentially more difficult to create a meaningful, fulfilling life. It really is as simple as that. What values are and what they are not. When I ask you to think about what your values are, what words come to mind? If you're like most people, you might find yourself listing abstract qualities: honesty, integrity, trust. Or perhaps you would refer to a set of religious beliefs, a patriotic ideal, or a code of morality. These are probably not really your own personal values. Rather, they're what I call social idealisms, socially acceptable ways of thinking and behaving. Social idealisms sound nice, but they don't necessarily reflect the true driving force that shapes your perceptions, decisions, actions, and feelings. You might genuinely believe that you are inspired by these ideals, but they are more likely to reflect your ideas of how you should, ought to, or have to behave, not what you truly value most. You can recognize social idealisms because they are usually presented as general statements and abstract categories. People should be honest. Treat others the way you want them to treat you. A good person goes to church, synagogue, mosque, or temple. An evolved person is always generous or altruistic. True values, by contrast, are as specific to you as your fingerprint, your retinal pattern, and your voice print. Perhaps what you truly value most is spending time with your family, listening to beautiful music, and the chance to play basketball several times a week. Or perhaps you value stylish clothes, nursing injured animals back to health, or expanding your enterprise's global reach. Your highest values may change throughout your life. Most people's do. But they are still the very essence of you. What you're drawn to, what you inevitably seek out, what you live for. They are a kind of internal compass, pointing you toward the activities, people, and places that most fulfill you, and away from the situations and people that are likely to feel unfulfilling. If you think of which activities and relationships truly nourish your innermost being, those are your highest values. Just as no one else can choose your fingerprints or alter the pattern of your retina, no outside authority, no parent, teacher, political leader, or religious figure can define your values. Only you can look into your own mind, heart, and soul, and discover what is truly most important to you. Of course, you may find some similarities between your values and those of others. For example, both you and another person may love learning. But one of you may love to learn facts and figures, while the other revels in mastering profound philosophic concepts. Or perhaps one of you delights in mastering the ins and outs of investments in the stock market, while the other loves to invent complex financial instruments. In the domain of home and family, perhaps two parents equally value nurturing their children. But one expresses that nurturing through providing challenges and discipline, while another expresses that nurturing through long conversations about feelings and offering comfort in times of difficulty. As you can see, even when two sets of values seem to be similar, one person's values will never be quite like anybody else's. If you and another person had exactly the same values, one of you would not be necessary. The world needs many different individuals, each with a unique set of values. Your unique purpose is to understand and fulfill your highest values. It is both a spiritual quest and the key to a fulfilling life. This is why I suggest that you focus on your own personal journey of self-discovery and not allow social idealisms or possibly stagnant traditions or conventions to cloud the clarity of what really matters to you. Social idealisms that you learn from your parents or teachers may lead you to believe that you should save money. But if buying a movie ticket, a motorcycle, or a more expensive house is more in line with your true values, you will spend instead of save. Social idealisms picked up from your family or the culture around you might cause you to think that you should put in more time at work. But if going home to be with your children, meeting a beloved friend, or keeping a date with a potential life partner reflects what you really value, you will consistently find yourself leaving work early to fulfill that true desire. People will naturally act in accordance with their own true highest values, spending money on what they truly value, spending time in ways that reflect what is most important to them. However, if they are not aware of their own values, and particularly if they believe they should follow the values of another, they will likely experience frustration and other self-depreciating emotions when they expect themselves to live outside their true highest values or even attempt to do so. So if you want to know why you are not doing something you think you should, or why you can't stop doing something you think you shouldn't, the answer will almost always be the same. You are inevitably going to do what you truly value most. You may be frustrated with yourself because you expect yourself to live outside your own true highest values. But however you feel about your shortcomings or your bad behavior, you will in fact continue to behave in whatever way aligns with your own true highest values. By contrast, when you become aware of your own highest values and wholeheartedly pursue the goals that express them, your life will begin to embody the kind of fulfillment and inspiration experienced by history's extraordinary leaders and achievers. Awareness of their highest values is the secret of their achievement, and it can be the secret of yours. This is why becoming aware of those true highest values is so important. This is why I've written this book, to share with you the power of the values factor. How do you know when you are expressing your true highest values and when you are reflecting social idealisms? I'll offer some powerful exercises in the next chapter that will reveal your true highest values. Then, throughout this book, I'll show you how to use those most important values to help you reach goals that have been eluding you, from finding a life partner or establishing a business to saving money or losing weight. Meanwhile, here's an important clue. Anytime you find yourself saying, "I should," "I need to," or "I really must," you can be pretty certain that you are talking about social idealisms or the values of some external authority, instead of expressing your own true highest values. When you hear yourself saying, "I desire to," "I choose to," or "I love to," then you know that you are talking about a goal that is truly valuable to you. Those are the goals you will inevitably achieve because they align with your highest values. But when you take on goals that are not aligned with your highest values, then you will, in all probability, struggle. External influences often seem to make it difficult to achieve your goals. Going within to choose your goals means that those goals are far more likely to be achieved. Values come from voids. One of the things that is most powerful about our values is how they reflect what has been perceived as lacking in our lives, the seeming difficulties, challenges, obstacles, sorrows, or voids. Whatever we perceive is missing sets off a powerful hunger for precisely that thing. The perception or lack of void creates a corresponding value that drives us until we feel fulfilled. For example, when I was a child, I felt restricted by the braces I was forced to wear. I perceived that restriction as a void, a lack of freedom. At age 4, I begged my father to release me from that void. I promised to keep my hands and feet straight on my own, if only I didn't have to wear the braces. My father agreed. I was so thrilled to have filled that void, to have replaced restriction with freedom, that I have placed a very high value on physical movement and travel ever since. As a child, I simply ran everywhere, glorying in my ability to move without braces. Throughout my boyhood and youth, I placed a very high value on physical activity and went on to excel at sports. As an adult, I value travel, and I vow to visit every country on earth. To this day, I love being unrestricted, either by my physical location or by any type of limiting belief. Today, the universe is my playground, the world is my home, and every city is another platform where I can share my heart and soul. Isn't it remarkable to think that my lifelong value on freedom came at least partly from the early childhood experience of a void, a perception of a severe lack of freedom? Thus, at a very early age, I began to experience the way voids create values. I soon encountered another void that became another equally important value. When I was 5, I entered kindergarten, where the teacher frequently had us draw pictures. For some reason, my drawings were like the ones made by the girls, houses and trees and sky and sun, which we colored green, blue, and yellow. I seemed to have some gift with perspective and dimension, and I liked drawing those things. The other boys, on the other hand, preferred sketching armies and cars, which they colored black and red. So during drawing period, I repeatedly went to sit with the girls. Well, that didn't suit my teacher. "You're not a girl," she scolded me, "and you belong with the boys." For days, she would drag me over to the boys' side of the classroom, put a black or a red crayon into my hand, and tell me to draw like they did. Even at that early age, I just couldn't do what other people told me to do unless I believed in it myself. I couldn't draw like the other boys, and as soon as the teacher walked away, I'd go back to sit with the girls. So eventually, I was made to sit in the middle of the classroom by myself. "You are not a girl, and you won't play with the boys, so you're just going to have to sit in the middle," the teacher scolded me. Here was another confrontation with a void. Not being allowed to be myself. I wanted to be creative in my own way, so I could discover the activities at which I was truly exceptional. Instead, I was being asked to fit into what conventional society expected of me. From that void developed one of my highest values. I learned how important it was not to let authority stop me from being true to myself. I placed an equally high value on helping other people find the means to become their true selves. Being forced to sit in the middle as a so-called punishment also helped me value the idea of embracing all sorts of polarities in life, which in turn assisted me later on in finding the middle path with a more gender-balanced perspective for the rest of my life's journey. In first grade, I encountered yet another void. I was supposed to learn to read, but I showed early symptoms of dyslexia, and I couldn't make any meaning out of the letters, words, or phrases on the page. I couldn't pronounce the words either, so I was diagnosed with speech problems. From the regular class, I was put into the remedial class, and from the remedial class, I was put into what they called the dunce class. My parents were called in and told that I would never be able to read, write, or communicate. They were informed that I would never amount to very much or go very far in life. From that series of voids, I eventually developed a very high value on reading, studying, learning, and teaching. And so every one of my voids created the values that continue to shape my life today. Although I was not supposed to go far in life, I went on to build a multi-million dollar global business. Although I had difficulty reading and speaking, I became an internationally renowned writer and educator. And although I had once been called a dunce, I went on to graduate from college with honors, to teach myself numerous specialties as an expert in a number of different areas, as I conducted advanced research in multiple fields, including philosophy, psychology, anthropology, physiology, chemistry, mathematics, physics, and astronomy. Challenging as these childhood experiences seemed to be at the time, they were the essential voids that shaped my highest values. Because I had been previously blocked in my learning, I valued knowledge. Because I had been unable to communicate, I valued teaching and writing. Because I had felt trapped, I valued travel. And so I discovered this key principle: perceived voids create values. What you perceive as lacking, and want more of, determines what you value. Significantly, this is a never-ending process. When one void is filled, another opens up, spurring you to new efforts and new values. Indeed, some voids might never be filled. The artist, hungry for self-expression. The mystic, eager to know the secrets of the universe. The scientist, ravenous for new knowledge. The person of service longing to help humanity. These people are driven by voids so great that their values become equally great. An entire lifetime might not be enough to fulfill their highest values. Other voids can be filled more easily, so that the values they engender are left behind. A young man might feel a void of self-confidence, so that he values impressing others or proving to himself what he can do. Later in life, he feels more confident, and so his values shift to other areas, serving others perhaps, or raising a family, or founding a new enterprise. A young woman feels a void of self-love, so she values relationships that feed her need to be admired. Later in life, she appreciates herself more fully, and so her values shift to other areas, deepening her romantic and family relationships, perhaps, or expressing herself, or exploring new ideas in science or business. Thus, some of our values change throughout our lives. Others remain an essential part of who we are. Either way, however, your perceived voids determine your values, and your values shape your life. That is why understanding your highest values and organizing your life to pursue them is the secret to living an inspired and fulfilling life. The power of values. If there is something that you believe you would love to have in your life, such as a more fulfilling career, a life partner, or greater financial freedom, I can tell you that the reason you don't yet have it in that particular form is almost certainly that you don't truly value it enough. There is something else you value more, and that is where your energy, time, money, and focus have gone, whether you are aware of it or not. When you truly value something, you are constantly on the lookout for opportunities to fulfill that value. You'll notice people, places, things, ideas, or events to fulfill your value that another person will surely miss. You will mobilize your energy to take advantage of those opportunities, and you'll bring all your mental, physical, and spiritual resources to bear to make sure that you fulfill what you truly seek. Your highest values determine your attention, retention, and intention, what you notice, what you remember, and what you intend or act upon. We hear a lot these days about attention deficit disorder, the difficulties some people seem to have in being attentive and focusing steadily. But all of us have some degree of attention deficit disorder for the things we don't value. For the things we do highly value, we have what I call attention surplus order, which does a fabulous job of filtering your perceptions. Out of all the stimuli in your environment, the ones you notice are the ones that will help you fulfill your highest values. Your highest values will lead you to notice things that another person might miss, even if you try to point it out. I experienced a striking example of the power of attention a few years ago when a close friend was driving us to her favorite sushi bar in Houston. We were on a block crowded with stores of all kinds, but out of that myriad of choices, my friend zeroed in on a new shoe boutique that hadn't been there the last time she drove by. She not only picked that one tiny store out of the dozens of other boutiques on that busy block, she even noticed two or three particular pairs of especially desirable shoes in the shop window. I, on the other hand, couldn't for the life of me see that store, even when she tried to show me where it was. I didn't share her high value for shoes, and so I couldn't break through all the noise in the environment to see what had immediately attracted her. Her values gave her attention surplus order for those shoes. My values made it virtually impossible for me to see them at all. On the other hand, I'm interested in city planning, so I couldn't take my eyes off the high-rise condominium that was being erected on the corner. I tried to talk to my friend about the things I had noticed, the design of the building, and the way it was being sited relative to the street, but I might as well have been talking about a building in China. She had driven right past that high-rise and not seen it, while I rode right past that shoe store and missed it completely. Her higher values determined her attention. My higher values determined mine. Between the two of us, which one is more likely to find fabulous shoes? Her values are perfectly aligned with that goal. If I decide I want a pair of quality shoes, I may have to momentarily realign my values to fit that goal, or link that goal to my highest values so that my attention surplus order leads me where I want to go. I will talk you through this process many times throughout the book, helping you complete it in various key areas of your life. Your highest values also affect what you remember, creating what I call selective biased retention. That is, you are far more likely to retain information that you believe will help you attain your highest values, and to forget information that does not relate to those values. My friend, to continue with the previous example, will probably never forget the address of that shoe store. I probably wouldn't remember it if you paid me. Her memory leads her to fulfill her highest values. My memory leads me to fulfill mine. We all know people who say, "Oh, I can't remember anything. I have a mind like a sieve." And then they rattle off the scores of their favorite teams, the results of their latest blood pressure test and cholesterol count, or the details of their child's latest triumph in school. They may indeed have terrible memories for the things that don't matter to them. But for what truly matters, they have selective biased retention, the ability to select and hold on to the information that supports their highest values. Finally, your highest values create what I call selective biased intention, adding an extra power to those intentions that truly align with those most important values. If you place a high value on health, you'll make sure to get to the gym, even if you have to give up some other pleasures to do so. If you place a higher value on dressing for success, you might skip the gym in order to stop by your favorite fine clothing store. If you want to know what you truly value, look at what you make time for. Your highest values lend power to those intentions, and so they're the ones you fulfill. Think about the power we mobilize when we bring together attention, retention, and intention to fulfill our highest values. There is really no stopping us. A mother who has as her highest value her newborn child can sleep through a freight train and yet be awakened by the whimpering of her baby. A child who is immersed in a video game may not hear you ask, "How was school today?" but immediately looks up when you say, "Would you like to come with me to see that new movie you were talking about?" All of us have had the experience of forgetting the names of random guests at a party, except for that one attractive man or woman whose every detail is vividly etched into our memories. We've all had the experience of being too tired to accept an invitation from one person, and then jumping off the couch and getting ourselves dressed to take up the offer of somebody else. What we value most shapes how we process information, what we remember, and how we act, so that our minds, emotions, and intentions all work together to fulfill those most meaningful values. This is why your true highest values are infinitely more powerful than any social idealisms, and why it is so important not to allow social idealisms to cloud the clarity of your most inspiring values. When you are guided by social idealisms, you might try to do what you should or ought to. But if your attempts at maintaining attention, retention, and intention are not aligned with your highest values, you are likely to make only a half-hearted effort, and you often will not remain focused. By contrast, when you seek to fulfill your highest values, you focus instantly on whatever helps you reach your goal, and you mobilize every bit of your mind, body, and spirit to help you get there. That's why the values factor is the key to achieving a fulfilling life. By becoming aware of your highest values, you mobilize your deepest power. It's an unbeatable combination. How the values factor can help you achieve your goals. As you can see, becoming aware of your highest values exponentially expands your power to achieve anything you attempt to do. Discovering your true highest values creates a powerful synergy between your patience, your integrity, and your leadership abilities. Knowing your highest values vastly increases your patience and perseverance. When you seek to achieve a goal that aligns with your highest values, you develop the power to wait as long as you need to, persevering in any effort required to achieve your goals. Likewise, the values factor builds your integrity. Whenever you set goals that align with your highest value, you have true integrity. Your words, tone, and actions all add up to one clear, unified purpose. This integrity affects others, who see and respond to it, and it also affects you, as you strengthen and deepen your single-minded, wholehearted intention. In the same way, the values factor awakens your inner leader. When you are pursuing the highest values that you hold dear, you become empowered with certainty and clarity. You find yourself confident in the path that you choose to take, and are inspired to lead others, who may also be inspired by or along that path. By increasing your patience, integrity, and leadership, the values factor helps you achieve your goals. In fact, it is highly improbable that you would achieve any goal that is not deeply linked to your highest values. If there is a goal in your life that you have already met or are on the road to meeting, you can be pretty sure that it reflects the things you value most. What about the goals where you feel blocked or frustrated? Why are there some goals that you have tried and could not meet, maybe even several times, or some goals that seem so far out of reach that you can't even imagine trying for them? Those seemingly elusive goals feel as though they're beyond our grasp, either because they are truly unrealistic, or because they are not really aligned with your highest values. This is a powerful point that eludes many people, so let's look at it a little more closely. A truly unrealistic goal is one that doesn't take material reality into account. I'd be the first to agree that we can have an enormous impact upon the world around us, but that doesn't mean we can be or do anything we like, with no regard for external constraints. A person who wanted to enter a highly competitive field with no training or experience might be continually frustrated in the path toward this goal, though a realistic plan for getting the necessary training and experience might achieve results. A person who consciously sets his or her romantic sights on a potential new life partner, but who is unconsciously still deeply connected to a previous relationship, might be unable to sustain that goal, though the search for a different life partner might temporarily bear fruit. Values are extraordinarily powerful, but they aren't all powerful. So a certain amount of realism is in order. What about the realistic goals that you have been trying to meet, but are still not meeting? If you have a goal that frustrates you in this way, you have two choices. One, you might discover that you don't really value the goal enough after all, and that it is more of an idle fantasy than a true intention. Perhaps your goal is a remnant of something that once appealed to you as a child or a young adult, and you have held on to it, even while your actual highest values have changed. Perhaps your goal is more driven by social idealisms or the pressure of those around you, and you know, deep down, that reaching that goal would not be genuinely fulfilling to you. Letting go of a goal that you don't really value can be an extraordinarily fulfilling experience, That makes room in your life for new goals that you do value. 2. If you genuinely want to achieve a goal and find yourself unable to do so, you have another option. Find a way to link your goal to your highest values. I recently encountered a striking example of the first option. Someone who readjusted his goals so that they more accurately expressed his true highest values. My friend Joshua writes and occasionally leads seminars, but for a period of his life, he was a bit frustrated that he didn't have the kind of career that I do. He had in the back of his mind the idea that he wanted to be a best-selling author, an internationally renowned speaker, and whenever we spoke, I could hear that he felt some envy and regret. So one day, when I happened to be giving a seminar in his home city, Joshua and I had a long dinner, and we were able to talk over exactly what my life was like. How did I spend each hour of my day? What did I think about? Where did my energy go? What was my weekly schedule like, and my monthly schedule, and my yearly schedule? What did I have time to do, and what activities did I choose to forego in favor of what I valued more? My friend realized that the life that I loved so much would actually be deeply unfulfilling for him. He liked the idea of being a best-selling author and international speaker. But when he thought about the time spent away from his family, the mental energy given to conversations with editors and speakers' bureaus and hosts on TV and radio programs, the hours spent on airplanes and in hotel rooms, he realized that if he actually had a life like mine, he would be deeply frustrated and unfulfilled. Whereas my highest values are researching, writing, traveling, and teaching, all of which are perfectly aligned with the life I lead, his highest values revolved around home, family, lots of quiet time to think and write, and long walks in the woods beside his beloved house. None of those values would be fulfilled by having a speaking and writing career like mine. In fact, that career would actively frustrate his true highest values. That was why he had not fully mobilized his resources toward achieving that career. Yet he had somehow held on to the idea that such a career was his true goal. As soon as my friend got in touch with his true values, he let go of the goal that did not align with them. He gave up that nagging feeling that somehow he should be working harder to become a famous author, or he should be out seeking more prestigious speaking engagements. He realized that the life he wanted was the life he had, and he was able to free up his energy for goals that really did fulfill his highest values, working on his new book, deepening his relationship with his wife and children, making sure to find time each week for at least one long hike. On the other hand, I've worked with many clients who have chosen the second option, linking their unmet goals with their deepest, most important values. As a result, they have been able to achieve extraordinary progress in areas where they were formerly blocked. For example, I once counseled an extraordinary doctor who ran into a conflict between his value of healing and his goal of providing for his family. This dedicated health professional prized healing so much that every time he got a little money, he immediately spent it to acquire knowledge that he believed would help him become a more effective doctor. He couldn't afford to recarpet the house or get new furniture for the living room, let alone build a college fund for his children, or even pay his bills on time, because every single dollar he could spare went to attending scientific seminars and buying health-related books. After several years of this, his home was overflowing with books, and he had run his family into debt. His wife was angry that they might not be able to send their two children to college, and she was upset about all the hours she'd spent negotiating with bill collectors and creditors. His children couldn't understand why their father, despite being a prominent professional, couldn't give them some of the things their friends took for granted: music lessons, trips to the amusement park, family vacations. The doctor didn't care about unpaid bills or family vacations, but he was upset because his family was upset. He wanted to help his wife and children become more fulfilled, and he couldn't understand why he kept not meeting his financial goals. Yet however important he thought those goals should be, this man kept putting his learning and his healing first. Given his high value on healing and learning, and his low value on financial freedom, he was going to consistently choose books over his bank account. Unlike my writer friend, however, this doctor was not willing to give up his goal of fiscal responsibility. He saw how much his financial chaos was frustrating his family, so he came to me for help. The values factor to the rescue. I showed this dedicated man how to link his goal of financial independence to his highest value of healing. I helped him see that creating financial independence would actually free him to focus on his patients without having to worry about his wife and children. Furthermore, becoming more financially viable would give him more influence and prestige among other doctors and other health professionals, increasing the likelihood that people would listen to his opinions and follow his suggestions. He might even be able to fund research or build clinics with the fruits of his investments. With my help, he began to see more and more links between building wealth and achieving his healing mission. The doctor and I made so many links that he began to approach his old goals in a new way. Now that his highest value was linked to his goal of financial freedom, as well as to his goal of healing and learning, he brought to bear every ounce of his dedication to reaching all of his goals. It was as if the three goals, money, healing, and learning, had become one single goal, with each piece feeding the others, and with the doctor's highest values feeding them all. Instead of half-heartedly trying to put a few dollars into a savings account, the doctor now eagerly embraced the opportunity to study the financial pages, accelerate his rate of savings, make some sound investments, and multiply his wealth for himself and his family. At my suggestion, he began charging his colleagues for the opportunity to observe him at work, linking his value of sharing his knowledge with his goal of improving his finances. He also found ways of accessing health education information for free through the library. This was in pre-internet days, rather than spending so much money on books. Within a few months, to his family's great relief, my client had completely transformed his financial situation. Once this dedicated man had linked his real highest value of healing with his goal of financial independence, there was no stopping him. That is the power of the values factor. Making the most of this book. The value you get from this book will be in direct proportion to how deeply you engage with it. If you read this book as a passive observer, you will learn something, but you will not learn nearly as much as if you engage with it, deeply and fully, relating it to your own life, your own goals, and your own true highest values. Chapter by chapter, you will have the opportunity to discover your highest values and integrate them with your endeavors in each core area of life. The book begins with an explanation of how to identify your highest values, a provocative 13-part questionnaire in which you become aware of your current values by looking at how you actually live. With what do you fill your home and workspace? What occupies your time? What energizes you? Where do you spend your money? What do you talk about and think about? In which areas of your life are you most focused and organized? What inspires you? What are your most consistent long-term goals? What do you love to research and explore? Through this process, you come to realize that your highest values are not the social idealisms to which you give lip service, such vague abstractions as honesty or integrity, but the core purposes that drive your actions and shape your life. Understanding your highest values is the key to understanding yourself, your purpose, and your inspired destiny. It is also the key to creating a life's work that will fulfill you, forging relationships that will both challenge and nourish you, and tapping into your own unique genius. As I've said, my highest values are researching, writing, traveling, and teaching. Understanding these values has enabled me to create a life based on these values. I live on a luxury ship that enables me to travel the world even when I'm at home, studying the laws of human potential, and writing about what I've discovered. I also fly around the globe to teach others about what I've learned. Other people have different values. Rose Kennedy's highest value was raising a family of leaders. She spent her days nurturing, educating, and inspiring her children, grooming them for the leadership she envisioned as their birthright. She would not have found my life fulfilling any more than I would have been fulfilled by hers. Yet by understanding her own highest value and shaping her life accordingly, she both found fulfillment and was of profound service to others. Whenever I meet a parent who tells me that their highest value is caring for their children, I think of Rose Kennedy and the power she found in knowing her highest values. Each of us has our own highest values, which we understand and express in our own unique ways. I've already told you about my client, the respected doctor, whose highest values were healing, learning more about healing, and teaching others to heal. His life faltered when he tried to build wealth and to create a fulfilling life for his family in a way that was disconnected from his highest values. His life became far more productive and fulfilling when he found a way to link his wealth-creating efforts to his highest values so that he could build wealth and security through healing, learning, and teaching. Another client's highest value was dancing. Although she was middle-aged and slightly overweight, she was a graceful woman who simply loved to dance. When I met her, she felt despair about not finding work that fulfilled her, and she had absolutely no idea that at her age, she could create a life organized around her devotion to dance. By showing her the power of the values factor, I helped her build an international dance touring business based on the activity that she loved most. Her enterprise succeeded because it was deeply rooted in her highest values. This in turn enabled her to live her destiny, activate her genius, and create a fulfilling career. Once you have identified your highest values, it's time to align your goals to them. I show you how to use this process in the seven core areas of life: relationships, education, career, financial life, social influence, health, and your inspired spiritual quest. I explain the way to achieve fulfillment in each of these areas. Align your goals and your highest values. This might sound simple, because it is simple. When our goals and highest values are aligned, we access resources we never even realized we had, because finally, all of our abilities, stamina, and intention are mobilized together toward creating the life that we truly love, the life that suits our unique purpose in the world. Yet for want of understanding of this simple, powerful concept, most people are living lives of quiet desperation instead of the amazing lives of inspiration that are their birthright. No matter who you are or what goals you have, understanding the values factor can help you create an extraordinary life that inspires and fulfills you every day. Mastering the values factor. I feel grateful that I have been able to create such a fulfilling life, one that enables me to pursue my highest purpose. As a result, I have spent the past 2.5 decades helping hundreds of thousands of people achieve their breakthroughs, showing them how to discover their highest values and then set their goals accordingly. Now people all over the world are tapping into the enormous power of the values factor, a concrete approach to determining their highest values and using them to achieve their most meaningful goals. People who draw upon their own highest values can live truly extraordinary lives. They access enormous inspiration and inner drive to achieve even the most daunting task. They notice opportunities that others miss. They create fulfilling relationships of all types, with life partners, family members, colleagues, friends, and they put themselves on the path to fulfilling their inspired destiny. Knowing your highest values and applying your intentions accordingly gives you the opportunity for so many rewards in your life, everything from financial achievement, love, and more fulfilling relationships, to leadership, integrity, and a deeper sense of meaning. Mastering the values factor can mean the difference between a life that lacks inspiration and a life that is bursting with it, between a life that feels stagnant and one that is overflowing with purpose and inner drive. Mastering the values factor is the key to transforming and fulfilling your life. Chapter 2. Identifying your values. Choose a job you love, and you will never have to work a day in your life. Confucius. Now that you understand the importance of values, it's time to identify your own values, a process that could well be one of the most important actions you ever take. A famous proverb from the Greek tradition is eloquent testimony to the importance of identifying your values. Know thyself, be thyself, love thyself. How can you be yourself unless you know who you are? And how can you love yourself unless you are truly yourself, living your life according to your own highest values? Know yourself and your highest values. Live authentically based on those values. And love yourself for being a unique creature unlike any other in the universe. In other words, identifying your highest values is your first step on the road to self-knowledge, self-love, and fulfillment of your life's purpose. If identifying your highest values is most important, setting goals and intentions according to these highest values come second. Unless your goals and intentions align with your highest values, they have little probability of being realized. You simply won't mobilize the full power of physical, mental, and spiritual resources to bring those goals about. Knowing your highest values is not only the key to self-knowledge and self-love, it is the means by which you can accomplish any goal you set, as long as it is a true expression of your highest values. Of course, I don't recommend setting goals that defy any of the known laws of the universe. For example, I wouldn't suggest that you attempt anything such as levitation, which would violate the law of gravity. Such an effort can be obviously self-defeating. Being able to set goals in alignment with your highest values is the power of the values factor, the secret to living a full and meaningful life. Passion versus highest values. Because the way we talk about our lives has such tremendous impact on how we think and how we live, I'd like to take a moment to clarify a few terms. Ever since the 1985 publication of A Passion for Excellence by Tom Peters and Nancy Austin, the term passion has become increasingly popular. People often say, I've got to find my passion, or I'm looking for work or a relationship that I can be passionate about. As a result, many have come to believe that the secret to an inspired life is passion. Passion, however, is not a synonym for our highest values. Passion literally means suffering. It refers not to our most inspired or highest natures, but to our animal selves, the ungoverned, out-of-control emotions that often drive us toward immediate gratification, addiction, and other states that are, by definition, not aligned with our highest values. Passion often drives us to seek a kind of perpetual bliss that is unobtainable even as we strive to avoid unhappiness, challenges, discomfort, or suffering, which are ultimately unavoidable. So if you choose to live by your passion, you are not living according to your highest values. You are simply following the impulses and instincts of your animal nature, manifesting lust, greed, gluttony, sloth, and addiction, passions that can become significant obstacles to leading a fulfilled and inspired life. Indeed, when people live according to their lower values, when they follow other people's values or subordinate themselves to social idealisms, they often seek immediate gratification, passion, or some other type of addictive pleasure. Instead of starting on the long, rewarding journey of inner fulfillment of their highest values, they seek instant gains and outer pleasures. Rather than being driven by passion, truly fulfilled human beings will follow their mission, inspired by their highest values and most integrated being. Just as your values are completely individual and unique to you, so is your mission the expression of your own unique contribution to the world. Discovering this mission, the contribution that only you can make, is the key to a life that can be meaningful beyond your wildest dreams. If you study the lives of the greatest contributors to our world, you will readily discover that each of them danced to the beat of his or her own unique drum, following his or her own inspiration. They chose not to subordinate themselves or their highest values to others. Instead, they forged extraordinary lives in pursuit of their own inspired missions. Groundbreaking physicist Albert Einstein put it very nicely when he said, ironically, "To punish me for my contempt for authority, fate made me an authority myself." In a similar vein, American philosopher Ralph Waldo Emerson noted, "Envy is ignorance. Imitation is suicide." In other words, only by being true to yourself can you maintain your integrity, achieve your own authority, and find the fulfillment that you inwardly seek. The alternative was chillingly described by Emerson's contemporary Henry David Thoreau, who wrote, "The mass of men live lives of quiet desperation. What is called resignation is confirmed desperation." Thoreau saw quite clearly that most people never tap into what really inspires them. Instead, they subordinate themselves to social idealisms, what they think they ought to do, the values of others whom they look up to, or their own limited beliefs about what is possible for them. They stand in sharp contrast to the people who dare to leave a legacy by creating a life based on their highest values, a life that makes a unique contribution to current and future generations of humanity. Isn't it interesting that so many people subordinate themselves to great leaders, political, religious, and artistic leaders, and yet the great leaders achieve their influence precisely by not subordinating themselves? Great leaders refuse to placate the social norm, or to remain stuck in stagnant traditions or old paradigms. Instead, they embrace the challenge of giving birth to new ideas and new visions, and succeed in making significant and novel contributions to the world. You can do exactly the same thing if you choose. You can resemble the great leaders who have left their mark on history. You can draw on your truest self, as expressed by your highest value, to make a great contribution to the world. True, you may run the risk of being ridiculed and violently opposed until your truth becomes self-evident. This was the fate of such religious leaders as Jesus, Moses, Buddha, and Muhammad, and of such political leaders as Abraham Lincoln, Martin Luther King Jr., and Elizabeth Cady Stanton. Business leaders like Walt Disney and Steve Jobs were not readily understood at first, nor were groundbreaking scientists like Galileo or Charles Darwin. Yet these are the leaders whom many respect and seek to emulate today, the leaders whose discoveries, enterprises, and visions continue to shape our world. Each man or woman's power comes from their ability to understand and fulfill their own highest values and to shape their lives accordingly. The stakes here are very high. If you don't understand your highest values and build a life around them, you run the risk of being disempowered and overpowered by other people's expectations or commands. How do you know whether you are living according to your true highest values? Just look at your life. That old saying, "Actions speak louder than words," is especially true when it comes to values. Our lives are constantly demonstrating what matters to us most. For example, if you say you value health and well-being, but haven't managed...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.